All right, welcome to this new demo of the train that I posted a couple of days ago on Facebook and Instagram, etc. as well. This is near the Clyde Street gates, at just near where I live and have grown up, in Newcastle, Australia. So I'm just starting out here with a really basic sketch. I'm after a really strong light here. Yellow ochre seems to be my sort of favourite kind of go-to colour for the background sort of warmth. It dries off quite light, which it ends up sort of looking fairly natural as far as skies and things go. So I really dig it. Just really, really watery. It's just a wash. This is just to lay down the platform for everything else that comes later on. Had a bit of a problem compositionally here because it was really strong on the left hand side. Still an L-shaped composition, which is a good composition in general. Just had a bit of a problem tonally with the building on the left. Kind of made too much of it. If I was to do this painting again, I'd probably sort of eliminate most of the building and just sort of put a, you know, an indication of something, cutting it off at the front. Like a straight line rather of a building rather than the funky shape that it really is. Just put some, you know, like this is a little bit of grassed area here, so I just sort of throw in some, you know, drips and dots and different colours in just to make it a bit more interesting there. All this stuff is obviously just initial washes. So I'm going through, I've got the bluey purpley sky there just drying off, so that'll be, you know, obviously there'll be like leaving that as it is and not doing anything else to that, you know, will always make for a good bright sky. And I think if you do too much to your skies, your paintings end up losing a bit of that life and light, for that matter, and that vibrancy. So just be prepared to watch me drying. I think this is a very important sort of thing to see. Even though it's boring to watch, it's really important to see when it gets dried, because half the battle of watercolour is knowing when to do what and how wet your paper is, how wet your pigment is, how wet your brush is, all that sort of stuff. So, you know, and knowing what it does when it is at certain variations of moisture. Just want this to be pretty much dry. So I think, I can't remember where I start here. I'm just doing this voiceover, watching it as I've finished cutting it together, visually at least. So it'll be a little sloppy, but you'll get the idea. I'm doing this on iPhone headphones. I'm recording. That's my microphone. So yeah, just dark. I'm not really interested in what colour. I know that, you know, warmth will tend to come forward, which is kind of what we want here. But dark is good here, so that's fine. Now, I had a bit of trouble sort of separating the cast shadow that will come up in a second, but this building ends up looking... I kind of made a little bit too much of it from the start, you know, putting the windows and everything. I should have just kept it really just blank and plain, which is kind of what it ends up being. But yeah, I just thought I'd show the process and leave these sort of things in, these so-called sort of mistakes as such and little errors of judgment, because it shows how you can get around things and how you can, you know, fix things and think about how it should kind of be. Now, this is your little cast shadow that this building's thrown down across, as they're looking into a sunset there. And, you know, the dark line just sort of anchoring the building to the ground to separate it a bit. Yeah, just a bit too much, so. But don't sort of give up on it. While ever it's wet, you can just go back in and, you know, muck around, and you'll just keep an eye on what you're after, and you'll get it. And it ends up being an unimportant part of the painting anyway, so, you know, lessons learned everywhere there. And also, good thing, if it doesn't work, if what you see in front of you doesn't work, you know, the building that I'm sort of labouring over now, is it's kind of that shape when you're looking at it. It's that shape, it's big and sort of long, but it's just awkward. So, you know, like I said before, next time I would do it, if I would do this painting again, which I probably will because it's a nice subject, I'll just sort of leave it, you know, really basic. Change things. What I mean is it gives you that permission. You've got permission to change things around if it suits better. With the train, big, dark, brooding train. It's a coal train that sort of has about a million carriages, and everyone around Newcastle always gets stuck at the lights at the gates while they carry the coal around the place. Sometimes you can be stuck there they're that long. You can be stuck there for half an hour, 45 minutes. I think about half an hour is the longest I've done. But yeah, there are a few spots around Newcastle where it where the trains just go nuts and annoy the crap out of you. But make good subjects, because they're just dirty and dark, and when they're against that industrial sort of background and, you know, bright sunlight, bright, you know, sunset, you know, strong shadows, all that sort of stuff. Yeah, they make really nice subjects. But the train right now, as you're looking at it, it's just, it's real, it's cartoony. It's almost really sort of cartoony, so it doesn't end up like that. Now, let's just sort of dry it off a little bit, and I must have thrown some weird transition in there. But yeah, I'm just sort of starting to kind of work out what I'll do on that right-hand side, because right-hand side's, it's important too, because it's background and it gives the picture some more context, being, you know, because look, it's, you know, industrial sheds and all that sort of stuff. But I think backgrounds, you tend to overwork them. Sometimes they're most of the time they're the first thing you paint, so you tend to overwork it, and they become too detailed. But this one's kind of important because it needs to sort of show the area that it's in, you know, the train yard and train lines and all that sort of stuff. But yeah, we'll see how that goes. With the train, I've just sort of gone through with some. They're really a dark blue colour, but the light was making them pretty much black, so I just wanted to throw a bit of blue in there here and there, just to have a hint of what it is. And I've just kept a little, you know, on there. I took this photo with this one, and on the reference photo, those white parts on the roof of the train are just stark white, so I've just left them there. And they'll end up looking all right once it's all sorted. Here are these brushes that I use. People have been asking about these brushes. They're actually really cheap. They're really cheap and nasty, but they're great. I know I've forked out for the really good stuff as well, and these are the cheap version of that. And if I'm completely honest, I think they are better. They retain their points properly and better than the other ones. They hold just as much moisture, just as much pigment. Honestly, I can't fault them. They're a Jackson's brand, so they're from the UK. That's the Jackson's, it's from the UK, that is. But I'll do a whole thing on my gear soon. That'll probably be in my next video. I'll actually do a bit of a guide through the equipment that I use, because yeah, people are asking that sort of stuff, and I want to give people what they want. But I'm just sort of mucking around with the train here. Those, obviously, the windows and that, you know, shining straight through is never going to stay. But I just have to kind of, it's a balancing act, because you want a little bit of that light there, that reflective light on the glass, but you don't want it to be massive. As I work through that building again, just I'm splotching little bits out, splotching, you know, just misty it up, atmosphere. Now, on the left-hand side, as I looked at there, I should have left the building exactly as it looks right now. I didn't, but I should have. That works fine. But just sort of going through some, just putting some abstract little bits and pieces on the sort of ground underneath those buildings in the background over there on the right. Just put some dark paint, and I'm just about to get the palette knife out and do some sort of scraping, just to indicate some, you know, some garbage bins and little sheds and things like that. That's what I'm doing there with the palette knife. And It works really well. I like using palette knives and stuff. You use whatever tools at your disposal that you can get the results you want. With palette knives and scraping back, though, just make sure you do it on fairly thick sort of paint. Don't do it on a wash. Just be careful with it because it can ruin the paper and also, it'll ruin the look of what you're after. If it's a wash, it'll just go back, the water will just separate and then go back in, and ultimately you'll have a big scratch on your paper that you can't get rid of. Just working that blue back into the front of the train again. It is necessary. It does come through. I do tone it down a little bit, but it works better in the end. With the shadow under the train, there's nothing there. Like I've, it was just a shadow, a shady part, and it was just made up black and just scratched up a few little bits and pieces underneath it, just to indicate something going on there with wheels and mechanics and all that sort of stuff. These aside, basically these little telegraph poles in the background are really important. That vertical's really important to go up, to take your eye up out of the picture as well, and it'll give us, the tools to carry the power lines and, some horizontals and diagonals pretty soon. Now, here's again just playing with that building. You can see how frustrated I ended up getting with it because it's just annoyed the shit out of me the whole time. But yeah, once again, it's still like I'm happy with the end result, and getting there was, it was annoying, but it's all a learning process. You never stop learning, ever. Anyone who says they've finished learning is just full of it. But it's, I think where I sort of, I like what my head's doing here as far as what I'm trying to achieve. I'm just trying to achieve that little bit of perspective, that little bit of depth going in. But turns out it just doesn't need it as much as I thought it did. So, and see now it's looking too busy with the scraping and all that sort of stuff. So I'm pretty sure I get rid of most of that. But I don't want it to be just one solid mass either, and you'll see what I how I end up breaking it up later on. But I think it's coming up to a bit of a drying session, almost. Oh, there's some fingernail scraping going on there as well. I don't really think I'll let that dry in that point. I think I just stopped the camera to restart a new section. But just darkening up, just really want to make that. Because when you think of the focal point is the train, it's the top of the train, but it's also the bottom of the train where it hits the where the real darkness underneath the train hits the light on that grassy area. Really like that. There's the little lines going back, those perspective lines. On the right, as I look at it now, when you're halfway through, just sort of keep squinting your eyes, and things will pop out to you that are not pleasing you. The darkness of the little triangular sort of rooftops on the right-hand side are annoying me, but I'm pretty sure I fix that up later on. Just going through some really fine lines here for some power lines and things like that. I love doing this sort of stuff. It really makes everything look the way it should and industrial and yeah, just nice. But you've got to keep them really fine. Here's the thing. Don't use your rigger, your fine brush. I got like a thing, it's an Alvaro Castanet. It's a needle point brush. I think it holds a fair bit of moisture, but with these sort of things, you want the paint to be a little bit drier than you'd expect, so you get that dry brush stuff going on. Now, here's just a bit of yellow ochre because it's got a bit of body on it, body to it rather, and it's just hanging around on the right. Then just gonna indicate some tracks. Like I don't want to. Obviously, there's a train there. It's driving on train tracks. It's not on water, so you don't have to draw perfect parallel train tracks because it's there just to indicate it. And I think they end up being a little more indicative as it goes through. But I'm just sort of pulling things together now, sort of looking at little touches I can leave here and there. Sometimes they're just really abstract touches, like little little brush strokes, just bang, like that one there next to the train. Don't know what it is, it's nothing, but just adds that little point of interest there. The color I'm using for a lot of that stuff is actually called, it's a Holbein color. It's called Juan Brillante or something, or Brilliant or something like that. And it's essentially, it's just a Chinese white or titanium white, with a touch of yellow ochre in it. And it's like a, oh, it's not really a fleshy color, it's just like a really light creamy color. But it does well, so it doesn't, it's not as stark as just having pure white for your little highlights and things. Give it a go. It's Holbein. But I'll, once again, when I talk more in depth about my equipment, I'll show you that. Here's a perfect example of when you try something and it doesn't work and you can fix it. So I had the idea of putting some kind of, stoplight. It's a train track, there's stoplights everywhere. And it wasn't in my reference photo, so I couldn't see exactly how it was or where it was going or what to do. So I just made it up, and it was at the wrong height. It's on the right-hand side. Yeah, you can see a bit of red there. It was at the wrong height, and it just didn't work. But I ended up just sort of getting rid of that. As you'll see, I think it happens pretty soon. But once again, just little bits of white touches here and there. Yeah, there we go. Getting rid of that white, that little, blotch on the right-hand side. Actually, just cover it up with some sort of smoke and some steamy-looking stuff around there. Now, when you do this, make sure your paper's pretty dry underneath, like your paint rather, is pretty dry, because it does merge and will mix, and it'll dry off lighter than it is. But yeah, it can cause a massive mess if you're not careful. So just sort of pulling it together here, last little touches, and spraying it off. Now the picture I show you at the end here coming up is the final result, and that happens when you'll see how I broke up this bit on the right-hand side. Now this, putting birds and stuff in, I think it's essential really with those landscapes. I love it. I just use a little gel pen. It's like a black gel pen, and I use a white one sometimes for little fine highlights as well. But as it comes up here and going through now, I do work on it a little bit more and just get rid of a couple of little bits. But this photo coming up now is the final result, and you'll see that I mucked around and lightened up the and broke up the building on the left a bit more. Yeah, there it is there. So broke up that building, squared it up a little bit better, and see that light in that foreground is really strong. And the smoke on the right-hand side as well, where that unsuccessful traffic light thing was, it looks all right. But I really like the overall feel and the mood of the picture. I think it's done what I set out to achieve. But I hope you really enjoyed this tutorial, and we'll see you again soon. Click and subscribe and share with your mates. Put it on your social medias. We'd really appreciate it. Thanks, guys. You have a great day. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.